I welcome you all to the next class on industrial management. In this class, we are going to start Unit 6. Unit 6 deals with the social issues and environment. Simply stated, environment refers to our surroundings. But we have to see the environment from a broader perspective, not just the physical environment. We have an economical environment which deals with the economic activities people undertake towards the path to development. Human beings live in communities and groups. So we live in a social environment that brings forth a number of social issues. In addition, there's a cultural environment. The people are deeply associated with the culture. It is not just trees alone. Even human beings have got the roots deeply embedded to the land. The interdependence of environment and human beings is a reality of life. Every act of human beings affects environment in some way or the other, and every change in the environment in return affects the human beings, either positively or negatively. This planet is not the something which we inherited from our ancestors. It is something which we have borrowed from our future generations. We have an obligation to hand over this planet to the future generation in a purely livable and non-degraded form. So the every developmental activities which we undertake need to have an environmental perspective. That is, we need development, but we need the sustainable development. Our present development should not affect our scope for future development. Let us proceed. So in this unit, we are dealing with the Unit 6. This Unit 6 deals with the two issues, the social issues related to the development and the environmental the issues. In today's class, we'll be discussing the different components of environment. We will have a broader view of the environment and the classification of the environment. Then we'll view a 5-minute video on endangered species. The many of the species are endangered on this planet because of the human the actions. And then we'll go on to discuss the issues of the solid waste management. Specifically, we'll be discussing the municipal waste and the hospital waste management. In the next class, we'll be discussing certain burning issues such as e-waste management, the climate change, the global warming, acid rain, ozone layer depletion, and such issues. Let's first have a quick overview of the content we intend to cover in today's class. We'll start our discussion with the environment, the scope of environment, and the classification of environment. Then we'll watch a 5-minute movie related to the endangered species. Then we'll move on to discuss the solid waste, the management. As I already said, specifically we'll be discussing the municipal waste and hospital waste. That is the municipal waste and next the hospital waste. And as usual, we'll have an interactive quiz towards the end of the class. What is environment? Simply stated, environment refers to our surroundings. But the surroundings is a little the broader in scope, not just the ecological surroundings. It also includes the economical surroundings, the technical surroundings, the all sorts of the issues which are related to the human beings in addition to the physical and biological components which are already present in the environment. We need to remember that the existence of mankind is always related to the environment. Our quality of life is affected by the environment to a large extent. But this relationship is a very complex one. That is, the every action of the human beings will affect the environment, and every change in the environment affects the human beings. That is, in this complex relationship, we need to watch each of our actions from an environmental viewpoint, from environmental perspective. How does it change the environment, and how we can reduce the effects of negative changes on the environment because of the human actions. So simply stated, the environment refers to the physical, the component. Environment refers to chemical component. It refers to the biological component, the social component, cultural component. So all these components are part of our environment. And the most important thing is that these components are not independent. They are interlinked in a complex way. That is, the change in any of the component will directly or indirectly will reflect in the changes in the other components. Coming to the classification of this environment, in a way, we can classify environment into two categories. One, we call the natural environment. This natural environment consists of all our physical surroundings, including the biological, the components, that is the air, the water we use, the soil on which we live and use, the land, the forest, the wildlife. These are all the part of the natural environment. We have not created any of these things. These are the present in nature. The most striking feature of natural environment is its self-sustaining mechanism. That is, if there is change in any component of the natural environment, there's a proportionate change in the other component to offset this change. For example, before the intervention of the human beings, if you take a forest, there's a definite proportion of the predatory animals like lions and tigers and deers. If the number of deers increase, that gives more food to the tigers. The number of population of tigers increase, they will need more food, which in turn reduces the number of the deers which are present. That is, a ratio or proportion is maintained by offsetting the change in one component by a proportional change in another component. That's the most the important feature of the natural environment, which is not there in the man-made environment. That is, the second type of environment, we call it as the man-made, the environment. So these are the things the human beings have built. So man is a very strong, the environmental, the agent. The other things, for example, the animals have got the ability to change the environment to a very small extent. But human beings have got very strong potential with the advancement of technology to change the environment. We can bring about the drastic changes in the environment because of the technological advancements. We already brought about the huge changes in the environment by using the technology. We have built huge transport systems. We have built housing complexes. We have built huge dams, huge industries, the power plants. All these things have brought a number of changes in the environment. And the most striking feature of this change is that it is not counterbalanced by the other factors. That is, the changes which are brought about by the human beings become irreversible. That is, the environment is changed forever. The changes are not counterbalanced by other forces in nature. So we have to be very careful when we bring about the changes due to the technological developments. The man has already brought about a number of changes in the environment. There were a large number of species which were existing, which are existing now. But the many of these species are near extinction. Some of these species are already extinct. Let us watch a 5-minute video on the endangered species. So it will show the endangered species, critically endangered species, and already extinct species on the earth. These are all the species which are endangered, which are likely to be extinct if you don't take proper actions. Well, these are the critically endangered species which are very near extinction. Well, friends, these are the species which are already extinct. There is no way to get them back. Well, friends, we have seen some of the species which are endangered and which are already extinct. We need to remember that on this planet Earth, every species, every animal, every bird, every plant has got a useful role. The loss of any or extinction of any of the species is going to be a huge loss for the environment, for the human beings. If one species is extinct, there's no way to get it back. So we have already done a lot of damage by our developmental activities to the environment, and we have already done a lot of the irreparable damage. Now the further development, we have to be cautious to not to degrade or not to irreparably affect the environment. Now let's move on to discuss the issues related to the solid waste and their management. So by the human activities, we produce a lot of items which cannot be used again. We call it as the waste. This is part and parcel of our day-to-day activities, creating a lot of the unwanted items which we want to dispose. Usually in the urban day-to-day life, most of the waste which we develop is in the solid form. And somewhere or the other, we have to dispose the solid waste. And wherever we dispose it, it will create some sort of the landscape, the pollution, which is unavoidable. Sometimes this is also called the waste. The word which we use for the waste is the refuse. The solid waste are diverse. They include a number of the items. What we use in the urban life is a heterogeneous, the mixture of different types of solids. For example, the paper, the plastic, the cloth, the tin, the rubber, all sorts of items end up as solid waste from residential activities or from commercial activities. In the rural areas, the agricultural activities also produce a lot of the waste, and these waste are usually the homogeneous of a single type of the waste. That is, the many times waste are heterogeneous, sometimes the waste are the homogeneous. We need to dispose the waste. I can classify the solid waste based on their source in a different ways. One type of solid waste is what we call the garbage, which is nothing but related to the food. We need food for our survival, but this food also end up as waste in the form of some spoiled food items or part of the food items which cannot be consumed. So the leftovers of the food items and the items, the vegetable peels, the fruit peel, etc., which are used in the process of making food, this will end up as the waste, which we call it as the garbage. Another type of the waste is other waste which are not related to the food items, but what we call it as rubbish. These usually are of two types. Either some of the rubbish are combustible, some of are not combustible. For example, the paper is a combustible item. The cardboard is combustible, the textiles, the rubber, the leather, the plastic containers are combustible. That does not mean that we have to burn them. They are possible, they have got a potential to catch fire. Second item is the non-combustible items like the crockery, like our metals, the aluminium cans which we use, the tin cans, empty bottles. These are the rubbish which are non-combustible in nature. Then we have got the agricultural waste, in the form of different items, the jute items, the waste, the cotton, the rubber, the tea, coffee. All these will produce certain amount of waste in the manufacture. Coming to the sources of waste, from where this waste come, one of the source is our industrial activities. For example, the thermal power plant that produces the fly ash. Most of the industries produce some type of the sewage, the chemicals, some sort of sludge, paints, the toxic metals. Another source is the more hazardous waste, which are more dangerous. A typical example is a radioactive waste, which can affect the human health due to its radiation, toxic chemicals which are poisonous in nature, the flammable, the waste, the explosives, the hazardous biological waste, which emanate from the hospitals, from research centers. This is another the source of solid waste. Then we have the pathological waste. Usually the carcass of dead animals, the waste from the solid house, the parts of the animal body, these are all the pathological waste. We also have a lot of waste from the construction activities. That is, we construct the buildings, and after some years of usage, we may have to demolish the building and reconstruct the newer buildings. This will result in huge the amount of the construction waste. This will include broken stones, bricks, the dust, the plaster, the electrical, the fittings, the sanitary fittings which cannot be reused. These all will be the construction waste from the construction industries. Also, another type of waste is the aquatic waste. If you look at some of the lakes, you can see that the entire surface is covered by some plant growth. These are dangerous because of their prolific growth. In just one season, these aquatic plants can grow and cover the entire surface of the lake. So this will affect all the water activities, like the traffic, the transportation through the rivers. It will affect the fishing activities, in addition to spreading the waterborne diseases. And then there is also a number of the waste which is not included in the above categories. For example, the street sweepings, the road litter, the abandoned vehicles. All this will end up as a solid waste at some point or the other. Let us now briefly discuss the general causes of the solid waste pollution. One of the causes is typically the overpopulation. So I'm not referring to the population spread over a larger area, but the density of the population. If you look at this figure, you can see how crowded even the trains are. When the large number of people live in a small area, there is always the huge amount of the pollution, the pollutants which are created by the population living in the area. Then the money. As the people are growing richer and richer, they consume more and more articles. This consumption, the article, will result some sort of waste. That is, we overuse the items. We use items which are more than necessary. We use items which are not necessary because of the effluence. So this, the effluence or the richness is another, has got a negative side of creating more pollution. Then the technology. Technology is another aspect. We need the development, but this development is not at zero cost. It always affects the environment in some way or the other. So that is the environment is to be studied, analyzed in the light of the cost we have to pay in terms of the environmental degradation. So the technology is another the cause of large-scale pollution created by human beings. The per capita contribution of to the solid waste. This is not per capita income. This is the per capita contribution of the to the solid waste. This varies from place to place. This varies from the person, the area to area. So we need a good amount of human awareness. That is, the public participation can reduce the per capita contribution to the solid waste, in addition to the enforcement of the laws. Now let us come to the municipal waste. The municipal waste is one of the most common type of waste which we encounter. That is, the one type of the waste is what is called, we call it as rubbish. This rubbish refers to the combustible as well as non-combustible substances which end up our waste in our day-to-day life. For example, the paper, the scrap material, the broken glass, the wood, the cardboard, cans, whatnot. All sorts of items are created which end up as waste, and many times these are scattered. We dispose it off without any the precaution. They end up as a nuisance to the human population. Then we have got the garbage. This garbage is typically the food waste, the both the cooked as well as uncooked the vegetables. So this will result in the flies, the insect problems, the unpleasant, the odor. Then we have got the refuse, which include the ashes, which include the dead animals, which also includes the industrial, the waste. These are the three types of typical municipal waste which is produced in a normal urban life. Now let us come to the solid waste management. The solid waste management refers to the disposal of the waste in such a way that should not have the adverse environmental effect. That is, the whatever waste is generated, that has to be carefully disposed of in such a way that the environmental effects because of the waste are reduced. The objective of the solid waste management is to reduce the adverse effect on the environment to the minimum possible extent. Now let us discuss the different activities which are to be managed in the solid waste disposal. The first is the collection of the solid waste. This is a common sight in our the city life. There is some mechanism to collect the solid waste. Once the solid waste are collected, so they are to be disposed of in some place. So typically this is a disposal, the site of the solid waste. These are the two typical steps, but we need to remember that the best possible way of disposal is the alternative use, that is the waste utilization. We have to find out the ways of means of utilizing the waste for some productive the purposes. These are the three typical activities which are involved in the solid waste management. Let us discuss these activities in a little more detail. Let us first come to the collection of the solid waste. This is something which we see daily. The first thing is to collect the solid waste from different sources, because this waste, the solid waste in the urban life, is not in one place. It is spread across the entire city. Every household will have some waste or the other. Every industrial undertaking will have some waste or the other. So collecting this waste from these diverse the areas, this diverse location itself is going to be a very big the task. That is the first step in the collection. Second, the transporting the collection, the collected, the waste to the site where it is to be ultimately disposed. That itself is a huge work because the quantity involved daily is very large. So the large amount of the waste is to be collected and all this quantity of waste is to be disposed to the site for the disposal. That is the first part. Next is the disposal. The disposal is to be done taking into account certain important the factors. The first of all, the disposal is to be economically viable. That is, economically the feasible way of disposal is to be arrived at, and the disposal should be in such a way that it should not create any health hazard both to the human beings or for the other living the creatures. This should not cause any adverse effect on the environment. That is, the act of disposal should be done in an environmental friendly manner. This should not result in ugly sights or ugly odor or noise. That is, the aesthetically unpleasant the view should not be created by the disposal of the waste. And as far as possible, the disposal should be done considering the recycling of the materials in mind. That is, wherever possible, recycling is to be done. And where recycling is absolutely impossible, such things are only to be dumped in the disposal yard. Let us come to the waste utilization. Waste utilization is something which we need to very seriously think about because it has got a number of the advantages. It contributes to the economical development. That is, what goes as a waste, we are using it for the productive purposes. Automatically, this will create more employment opportunities for the people in the area of the waste utilization. This reutilization or utilization of the waste will effectively reduce the waste, and this reduction in waste will in turn cause the less damage to the environment because of the decrease in quantity of waste. When we are reusing the waste materials, we don't have to go for fresh natural resources. That is, we can conserve our existing natural resources by using the waste for our productive purposes. That means the same resources can be utilized for a more number of years by waste utilization. Of course, the waste utilization will naturally result in the useful products for our day-to-day the life. Now let us come to the techniques of waste utilization. The waste utilization typically has got 3 R's: reduce, reuse, and recycle. The first thing in waste management or waste utilization is the reduce. Reduce the consumption of resources. Use resources only to the minimum possible extent. Whatever the resource, the paper, reduce its use, the water, any of the products which we use for day-to-day life, the food items, the stationary items, the power, the electricity. First thing is that try to reduce it to the minimum possible extent. That is the first one, first R. Next is the reuse. Try to use the same item multiple number of times. use the item more than once. For example, the water can be cleaned, it can be purified, and which can be reused for non-drinking purposes. That is, the reuse of the resources goes a long way in the reducing the pollution. The third thing is the recycle. The recycling is a very effective way to reduce the number of waste. For example, the plastic can be recycled to produce the plastic maybe of a slightly lower quality, but we can use this plastic for the many of the products instead of using fresh new the resins producing plastic. Similarly, paper can be reused. Many of the things can be reused for reducing the waste. It is a very effective technique of waste utilization. Many times, the reclamation is another way. We are using the waste for alternative purposes. For example, using a cattle dung for the making cooking gas, the jute waste for making paper. These are all the making using a waste for alternative purposes. These are some of the techniques of waste utilization. Now let's come to another important the aspect of waste management, what is known as the hospital the waste. It is a big issue in the city life these days. The more and more the hospitals are coming, the more and more people are visiting the hospitals for the treatments. But the other side is that the waste is also increasing in the process of the hospital management. Let us discuss the different types of the hospital waste. Just like our home, just like our industry, the hospital also have got a number of the general waste. This general waste include general items, just like our domestic house. It is non-hazardous, the kitchen waste, the packaging materials, the paper, the wrappers, the plastic. These are all the general waste which are produced in the hospital in its day-to-day working. Then we have got the specific waste for the hospital. One is the pathological waste. This consists of the human tissues, the human organs, the parts of the human body, many times human fetus, the blood, body fluid of the humans. These are all the hazardous waste because there is every possibility of the infection spreading to that. In addition, because these are the human parts, these are to be dignity, these are to be waste to be disposed with the dignity also. Then we have got the more dangerous the waste which can cause the infection on a large scale, which contains the pathogens, the bacteria, the virus. Many of the hospitals and the laboratories, they test, they even culture the blood samples, urine samples to produce the bacteria, to produce the infection causing items. Now these are to be disposed very carefully, otherwise there is every chance of the contamination spreading because of this infectious waste. Another type of hospital waste is the sharp items which are not infectious, but it can cause physical harm. For example, the needles, the broken glass, the saws, the nails, the blades, the scalpels. These things cannot be disposed of carelessly because the people can come in contact with them. This may cause physical injury to the people. We also have the pharmaceutical waste in the hospitals. This is mainly the drugs. The drugs are necessary for treatment, but the drugs, the spilled drugs, the outdated drugs, the contaminated drugs are potential sources of pollution, the potential sources of harm to the human beings. The hospital waste will also include some chemical agents like the chemical items which are used for the cleaning, for housekeeping, for disinfecting, all these things may be discarded in the hospital. This will result in the chemical, the waste. In addition, we also have the more the potentially dangerous waste in the hospital, what is known as the radioactive, the waste. These are the radioactive substances which are used for the treatment or diagnosis or various different tests. These things are necessary in specific quantity, in specific grade, but after its use, the disposing it off in a careless manner may cause the radioactive damage to the human beings. Let us now discuss the different ways in which the hospital waste are disposed. One of the most common way in which it is disposed is the deep burial. In a deep burial, we make the deep pit, and this biological waste are put here. Then one layer of the soil is put, again biological waste are put. After some the filling, another layer of soil is placed and biological waste are put here. This is a typical deep burial pit. Here we have got the wire mesh to cover the pit, and usually by keeping a distance of about 50 centimeter, we don't fully cover it with biological waste. Then the soil is filled here over that. Next, it is also elevated, or it is the some elevated portion is formed here to avoid the seepage of water into this the pit due to the rainwater or the flow of water. After doing all those things, this the deep burial pit is also to be properly fenced with the wires so that people don't unnecessarily enter near the deep burial the pit. So this is one way of disposing the hospital waste in the hospitals. Another way of disposing the hospital waste is called the autoclaving, and also another way, what is known as microwave the treatment. The autoclaving is done in a machine. Typically the hospital will have a machine like this, the what is known as autoclaver. This operates something like a standard the pressure cooker. Here all the items to be autoclaved are put into this the drum. Then the steam is passed at very high temperature and at very high pressure, something like the pressure cooker. So this steam kills all the microorganisms which are present in the waste. Typically this autoclaving will disinfect all the possible sources of infection in the biological the waste. Another way of doing the same thing is microwave irradiation. This is something like our induction cooker. Here instead of the steam, heat is generated by high frequency waves, the microwaves. These high frequency waves generate a lot of heat by vibration. This heat kills all the pathogens which are present in the biomedical the waste. These are the two additional ways of disposing the hospital waste. Many of the waste are shredded before disposal. The shredding simply means the cutting it into small pieces. The many of the items can be shredded before disposal. For example, the IV bottles, IV sets, syringes, catheters, the sharps, blades, all those things are usually made into fine pieces and before the disposal. Sometimes the hospital uses the needle destroyers specifically for the destroying the needles. These shredded pieces or the items are sometimes the field in the deep burial, what is known as a secure the landfill. Even certain chemical substances, solid substances are disposed of using the secured landfill. Another, the equipment which is used for hospital waste disposal is what is known as incinerator. The process is incineration. The incineration is a process of the controlled burying, controlled the burning at very high temperature. So this is the equipment used for that. Here all the items are put inside this incinerator, and then the high temperature is produced inside this incinerator. Because of the high temperature, the waste material is converted into ash. It is converted into the flue gas and the heat. These are the three items they produced. By doing this, we can greatly reduce the quantity of the waste. The huge amount of quantity of waste can be reduced to very small quantity by using the incineration. This is typically installed in most of the hospitals. But we need to remember that we cannot incinerate everything. We should not incinerate the polythene bags, because that will produce a lot of the harmful gases in its process of burning. Now let's come to the hazardous waste, the management. We have seen that hazardous waste is a waste that they can cause the damage to the environment, as well as it can cause the substantial harm to the human health and safety. Such wastes are called the hazardous, the waste which have got a potential to degrade the environment, which has got a potential to the harm the safety and health of the human beings. The hazardous waste can be of different types. It can be of in the solid form, it can be in the liquid form, it can be the sludges, the mixture of the solids and liquid, it can be in the gaseous form. And these are the typically manufactured, the produced in the industrial the activities. The typical hazardous waste include the toxic waste, that is the items which can affect human health by its inhalation or by its ingestion or by touch. This toxic waste, when we dispose in landfill, that causes the contamination of the groundwater. Another type is the chemical waste that will cause chemical reaction, that may cause fire, that may cause corrosion and explosion. Another type of hazardous waste is the radioactive materials, which can produce the radio emissions, which can produce radio waves, which can cause the damages in the human beings. Then we also have the biomedical waste, which are infectious in nature, which can cause the infections, which can spread diseases. The unused, the bandages, the infusion kits, the bandages which are removed from the patients, these are all from the biomedical, the waste. The biomedical waste management is done just like hospital waste. The one way of doing it is the incineration, what we had discussed the earlier. Some of the hazardous waste can be treated by chemical treatment. For example, if the fluid is highly acidic, we can combine with alkali and neutralize the acid. That is a form of chemical treatment. We can also go for the biological treatment. That means different biological processes to purify or treat water, different types of the filtrations for purifying water. Another way of disposing the waste is what is known as encapsulation. So this is the typically done for very, very dangerous materials, the radioactive items. There is no way we can dispose a radio item in a landfill or in water. So wherever it is there, it will emit the harmful radiations for a very long duration of time. Say for example, the nuclear power plant. If this nuclear material after their useful period is over, still it will result in a waste that is going to be highly radioactive. These are disposed by encapsulation. That is, it is put in the very strong, the metallic containers, and these metallic containers are put in concrete containers, and they are buried below a particular depth on the earth, so that its radiations does not affect the human beings. Well, friends, so that's what we discussed in today's class. We started our discussion with the environment, the classification of the environment. We classified environment into man-made environment and natural environment. And we said the most important feature of natural environment is that any change produced in one part is compensated by proportional change in the other part, which is not there in the man-made environment. Then we discussed the types of waste. Typically, the waste which are generated by the urban population, what is known as the garbage, rubbish, and refuse. Then we also discussed the more dangerous waste which is generated by the hospitals. We also seen the different ways of disposing the hazardous waste. Thank you.